with this information, we can now focus on the part of the funnel that has the most upside for us in terms of new revenue, repeat purchases, or churn prevention dollars. Hey guys, what's up? John from Segments here. Welcome to the 9th episode of Ecom Data Cooler Talk, where we talk about important topics in e-commerce and data next to a water cooler. So we started this channel to make data science accessible and give e-commerce data powers back to the people. If you like the videos, hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. It really means a lot to me. Today, we're talking about customer lifecycle. We will explain how to use purchase behavior to organize customers into lifecycle stages and how merchants can incorporate customer lifecycle to optimize their marketing efforts. Okay, let's dive in. So what is customer lifecycle? Well, for e-commerce, customer lifecycle describes the different stages that a customer is in at a point in time in their relationship with your brand. If you Google customer lifecycle, you're likely to come across lots of infographics that uses the AARRR framework, which is acquisition, activation, revenue, retention, and referral, or something similar. Let's demonstrate the stages by going through an ideal customer journey. We have a customer, Sarah, who sees your ad online and visits your website. Upon her visit, she sees an email capture pop-up in exchange for 15% off her first purchase, which she then uses to make a purchase for a pair of jeans. After she's made her purchase, she receives a warm thank you email, which includes a free shipping offer for her next purchase, which she then uses to make a second purchase. At this point, she is invited to leave a product review, and she gets a referral code for 5 of her friends for $20. When her friends make a purchase, she gets the credit too. I've just outlined a simple example of a customer journey going through the different stages of a customer lifecycle. This information you can find online on most analytics and marketing websites. What it fails to tell you is how to leverage data to actually move customers further down the funnel where customer value increases exponentially. Here's an example of a customer lifecycle grid from Segments. Let's take a look at how this was created and what it means next. So what goes into customer lifecycle? Well, to make it come alive a bit more, let's first simplify it. We only focus on the stages after we've captured customers' emails, right? Then we can simplify it as this. Purchases. Think of pre-purchase and post-purchase. So then starting with zero orders, which is pre-purchase, and then post-purchase, you have one-timers, two orders repeaters, and three or more orders, right, as your loyal customers. Right, forget about the AARRR framework and just think in terms of number of orders that they've previously made. It's as simple as it gets. And the goal remains the same. We want to move customers down the funnel where their ECLV increases with each purchase they make. On average, we see that loyal customers with three or more purchases have 10 times higher CLV than average customers with zero or one purchases. Okay, so now we're ready to do some marketing automation flows, right? Well, not quite yet. Before you start plugging these customers into thank you series or post-purchase series, what most marketing automation flows fails to take into account is the conversion risk. At each of these stages, we have to pay attention to the recency of the customers. For pre-purchase, it's the number of days since they signed up. For post-purchase, it's the number of days since their last order. The more recent, the better the engagement, and the more distant, the higher the churn risk. If you plotted the purchase likelihood of a customer by recency, it might look something like this, where we have purchase percent from 0 to 1 and recency in days from 0 to, let's say, 365. And it might look like something like this, where a small increase near 0 and where it drops off and tapers off very slowly. What we can do then is to calculate these inflection points, which purchase intent changes significantly, and use that to inform our marketing and offer better contextualized, precise marketing campaigns. And how do you calculate these inflection points? Well, you can aggregate all the individual repeat purchases up until day X, and you have created the cumulative growth chart. And what this growth chart tells you is the number of repeat purchases that happened by week 1, week 2, and so on. And then you can do some simple calculus to find the inflection points, which we call the growth point and then the at-risk point. Everyone to the left of the growth point are more likely to convert than anywhere else in the curve. Customers between the growth point and the at-risk point are probably forgetting about you by the day, and so you may need a stronger reminder on why they need to purchase again. Customers who have lapsed beyond the at-risk point have most likely churned, and you may need to deploy a win-back strategy where email marketing alone is not enough. And here's the opportunities grid again. So we now see the customer value increases vertically down the funnel with more purchases, and conversion risk increases to the right, farther away from the last purchase. Next, let's look at a few example use cases of customer lifecycle and why you should care. What can customer lifecycle do for me? As we've seen previously, we now know how many purchases each customer has and what level of conversion risk we are facing. With this information, we can now focus on the part of the funnel that has the most upside for us in terms of new revenue, repeat purchases, or churn prevention dollars. Number one, pre-purchase flows. Everyone probably already have a new signup flow, but consider this. If you knew your chances of converting new customers drops significantly after 48 hours, would you still schedule your campaigns the same? What type of high conversion asset could you send with intraday delays without annoying your customers? If a customer has not converted within the first 2 days, what type of offer would you be willing to send to at-risk customer? You may be surprised, but for most stores, we've seen that there's minimal conversion after day 7. And so if you got a series running longer than that, then you've got opportunity to improve your timing. Number two, post-purchase flows. Similar strategies apply here. You want to send a personalized thank you email to your customers and make them feel appreciated and build a sense of community around your brand. You want to increase the level of appreciation and value with each additional purchase that the customer makes. Once customers lapse into the at-risk stage, you have to be very purposeful with your email. We have seen email open rates drop by half as soon as they enter the at-risk stage. This is why sending contextualized, precisely timed campaigns around these inflection points can help you increase conversions. Number three, suppress and win back. Once customers have lapsed the at-risk point and enter into the win-back stage, they most likely have churned and have a very low likelihood of returning. So what you want to do here depends on the value of the customers. For those low-value customers who've never purchased, you may want to leave a B. And you can actually save money by going to your email tool and suppress these active profiles. Depending on the tool you use, you may be saving hundreds of dollars a month. For those high-value churn customers, you should try and win back those valuable dollars through retargeting and other promotional campaigns with different channels besides just email. In summary, we looked at what is customer lifecycle through a typical customer journey. We simplified customer lifecycle as the number of purchases, and we quantified conversion risk based on purchase recency. Lastly, we highlighted a few examples of segmenting your customers by lifecycle to create contextualized, precisely timed marketing campaigns. Finally, data is power, and we want to give e-commerce data powers back to the people. So join us and start growing with your data today. If you enjoyed the video, please don't forget to hit subscribe.